One more point, since we are on to discussing the role of the anti-Hindu, the Hindu-phobic or the left or whatever, Pollock is a very special person to them because he knows Sanskrit very well, which Ramila Thapar didn't know, Irfan Habib didn't know, these kind of people didn't know. And so he's very special in this, and he's filling this gap of the Indian left, and he's trained all kind of Westerners and Indians to sort of do this political philology. So this new approach to Sanskrit studies, you will notice some people in your CSDS also have come
back. Yes, my God.
Now they can quote some Shastra to make their point. So now it is Marxism armed with some Sanskrit stuff they can quote. This has become very dangerous.
Not only that, let me tell you, very recently, some of my colleagues who have taken on this challenge, you know, because as you mentioned yesterday in your lecture, that earlier these leftists, when they said something, people said, but you haven't read, how can you say you can't read Sanskrit, you can't read Marathi, you can't read any of the languages. So they started actually taking the reading of these texts seriously. Right. So some of my colleagues set up a reading circle, a reading group for these texts. You know, they had a Mahabharat study group, and then the second one was Manusmriti, Manusmriti study group.
Right.
But again, the person they invited, or the person they, three American scholars came to train them in reading or interpreting Manusmriti, and I asked them,
so what has happened,
why not a pandit from Varanasi?
Exactly. So what has happened is, in one stage, the Americans have taken over the interpretation, and the further stage is they are now the producers of knowledge, Indians are the consumers, they are now coaching the next generation of Indians, who will then go through society, trying to expunge so-called violence in the text. You know, so he wants to decontaminate the texts. He clearly writes that he wants to make it safe, remove the toxicity. These are words used in Pollock's writings, that what he calls liberation philology. Mm-hmm. Political philology is looking for the politics. Liberation philology is now liberating the people from that toxicity by getting rid of all those things which are bad and dangerous according to their point of view. So giving Hindus our human rights. So now they're going to give our Hindus rights. So in a sense, one person made a very insightful remark on what I'm doing. He says, you know, what you are doing is you're uncovering that they want to write the new Smritis. They want to write new Smritis. They're training Smriti writers who will make it look like, hey, these are Hindu Smritis, but they will become exceedingly left-wing Marxist new Smritis. So this will be the Charvak 2.0, in the sense that it's extremely atheistic, nothing wrong with that.
No, it's not atheistic, I'm sorry. I don't agree with you there. Because the impetus is coming from the evangelicals.
Yes.
From those who are very angry with India
right. For
not having succumbed wholesale
right. To
conversions right. To Christianity.
Right.
I think
the end game will not be conversion to Judaism. And the end game is not going to be...
Judaism is not even on the table.
Right. And the end game will not be a conversion to some kind of a communist state because communism is on the way out. It's just an intermediate step to get rid of the Hindu context, to get rid of the Hindu, you know, institutions and the meanings of these texts that have to in people's lives, so that it becomes an easier thing to Christianize.
See, when you said the agenda is not even communism, in fact, not at all.
Right.
But it's very noteworthy that Western universities, especially now the Americans, will patronize only leftist scholars for whichever discipline.
Right.
Except maybe economics, where people like Arvind Panagriya may...
That's because the multinationals exactly, want to have free markets.
Exactly. Other than that, history, sociology, political science.
The social sciences are all
social sciences are